Thank you. I assure you, I'm indeed honored and flattered to be here and to have a cozy and distinguished audience. I also want to applaud the library and the Center for International Studies for doing these kinds of things, precisely the kinds of activities, no matter what the turnout and when, that we is really part of the current and the mainstream of academic life on campus. I was very impressed to walk in today and see the displays out in the library about issues of torture and repression and desaparecidos in Latin America that you have out there. Very, very well done. Those ring close to my heart. But I am honored to be here. I enjoyed very much the program that was given last month on Irish immigration and look forward to those that are coming in the coming months. I was in the Dominican Republic this summer and wrote a doctoral dissertation on the U.S. intervention there years ago, so I'm especially interested in that one and the ones to come as well, and how timely they are, the topics. I want to begin today with two quick vignettes. One is probably lodged in sort of urban mythology, and a second that's certainly recorded in the due historical record to sort of set the stage for what I'd like to share with you today. The fable goes something like this. It's somewhere in the time of the late 1980s and early 1990s, and there is a Slavic peasant with his wife and children and all of their belongings on a cart pushing their way through somewhere in probably Eastern Europe. And it had just followed the dismantling of the Soviet Empire, the Soviet Union, and the disintegration of in the Balkans of the former Yugoslavia. And so 22 brand new states are all of a sudden in our midst. It's one of those seminal times of the 20th century when that does happen. The world is different. And the Slavic peasant finds himself at a check station and is asked for his papers. He shares them with him and he says, and the guy asks him, well, where are you going? And he says, do you have a map? I'm not quite sure. He looks at the map and he turns it upside down, looks at the other side, and he hands it back and he says, any chance you have a different map? The world had indeed changed for him, and that's really part of the world we live in, not just at that time. The other comes from a favorite story of mine that's recorded in the biography of Sir Ernest Sattow. Now, Sir Ernest Sattow was a very prominent British diplomat of the late 19th and early 20th century, who was, among other things, very responsible for not only practicing diplomacy, but studying it and teaching diplomacy to young diplomats-to-be going out in the British Foreign Service. And on one occasion, there was a group of young diplomats about to venture out to the Far East after their initial training. And in their closing session, one young diplomat-to-be said, Sir Ernest, how in the world do you expect us, despite all this training, to understand the inscrutable Oriental mind and all that it embodies? And the account is that Sir Ernest looked at him rather sternly and he says, young man, do not worry what's in the minds of those inscrutable Orientals that you're about to interact with. You need to primarily be concerned with what's in your mind and try to unravel that. And the rest will probably take care of itself. And I think there's great wisdom in that today. And I certainly feel that as I talk about a topic as important and as complex and as changing as the topic of understanding China today. My own experience in China has included a full year's residence in China, teaching at the Foreign Affairs University in Beijing, China, which is one of the, which is a university that was founded in the late 1950s by Zhou Enlai, one of the major principals of the Chinese Revolution and the early Chinese state, in which was founded primarily to train and educate young Chinese diplomats, ostensibly to enter into the Chinese Foreign Service, and has retained that mission ever since. And it's retained its size, despite the fact that in China everything is large. This particular university has retained its small size by design of just a couple of thousand students. So it is, along with Peking University and Tsinghua University in Beijing, probably one of the two or three top universities in the country, particularly for this kind of purpose. So it was an extraordinary experience. My wife and I both went. She's here today, so she can correct me about some of these things. It was an enormously rich, enriching experience. I learned a lot about China. I learned a lot about myself, and I hope to be able to share some of that with you today. But prior to that, I had been to Asia also prior to that in the late 1980s and 1988. I spent two or three weeks in Asia under the auspices of an entity called the Asian Resources out of Washington, D.C., in which I spent some time in Vietnam, in Laos, in the Philippines, and in Thailand for several weeks. So my first formal introduction as well, and the second one was much more personal but equally as important. In 1906, I ventured back to China with my daughter and her husband to pick up their daughter and my granddaughter, which was an extraordinarily interesting and personal experience, and spent a couple of weeks there in the southern part of China as well. In addition to that, I've had the good fortune that my life has been enriched by the fact that I myself, Chris and I, have three children from Asia. Two from Vietnam, one of whom is here today. That's a son and a daughter from Vietnam and a daughter from Korea as well. And I'd always taught courses in international politics, international relations, and comparative politics, and it was certainly true for me professionally that I always tried to include a section of some kind on China, either in a comparative vein or as a major actor on the international scene. But there's nothing like seeing it up close and personal as well. So in that sense, you have to pardon me, I'm going to walk back and forth. We don't have a clicker today. I want to just remind you of a couple of things that are important when we take on these kinds of topics. I fit into the first one up there, so I'll just ignore that. But these other two I always want you to think about as we move through complex topics like this. One drawn from what is arguably my favorite novel, To Kill a Mockingbird, which reminds us that sometimes we have to get inside the skin of others to understand their point of view as well. I also like the reminder, somewhat acerbic, from Mark Twain, who said, you know, what gets us into trouble is not what we don't know. It's what we know for sure, or at least think we know for sure, that just ain't so. And that can be a real problem. And the bottom one is from Steve Covey, and it cuts it off a little bit, but it's intended to deal with personal relationships, but it goes, the human tendency is to judge others by their behavior, and to judge ourselves by our ideals. That also, I think, plays into accounts like this as well. And I hope you'll kind of keep those in mind as we move through. But I want to take the time today and share with you what I think are about five major areas that we could benefit from in understanding modern China and some of the changes, like our friend the Slavic peasant find the map is different, and it's different in many levels, not just the map about geography. And I want to begin by talking about the point that simply China looms very, very large in our thinking of what we do. And I've superimposed here just a map of the continental United States for your comparisons here, just to think about it. If you think about it in that vein, China is, in terms of size, just about the same size as the United States. It is, in other ways, not only much different, but also much, much larger. It is, of course, an ancient society, and in many ways, a brand new state. A brand new state in the sense that on October 1st, literally a week ago today, was the 65th year of the modern Chinese state, of the Chinese Revolution. And in the scheme of things, that's still a fairly recent time. But to think about China in an ancient society in a more historical vein is, of course, absolutely essential. China can identify in its rich several thousand years of history at least 28 dynasties, some 500 different emperors at various times, by almost any account, it looms very large. But let's just think about the basic numbers of today. Population of China, somewhere around 1.3, 1.4 billion people. Geographically the size of the United States, but think about that. We're talking about a piece of geography of size of the United States with four times the number of people living in that space. Essentially one-fifth of the world. And I would suggest that you have to go even farther than thinking about that. If you take China and link it with India next door, almost equivalent size, and you add to it something like maybe Indonesia to the south and Japan, you're talking about half of the world's population. in a fairly small area of the world. But just think about what this means in terms of a population four times the size of the United States. If you took the United States population and added Mexico, which I think today is in the neighborhood of 115 million, and added Brazil, which is in the neighborhood of 210, 220 million, and added Colombia, and added Cuba, and added all of the Caribbean, and all of Central America, and all of South America, and all of Canada, and all of Nigeria and Japan, you're almost there. You're almost there. So, you know, just that is a big reminder by itself. It's also a world that shares borders with 14 countries. Put yourself to a little test sometimes. See if you can walk around the borders of China and identify those 14 countries. It means that China as a state has border relationships. The politics of borderlands is something very, very interesting. We have what, two? At least by land. And talking about 14 different entities at the present time. Now, some of those, of course, are brand new states that our Slavic peasant was looking for over here on the west side that are remnants of the old Soviet Union, the old Soviet Empire, beginning with Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, and of course the Russian Federation and Mongolia as well. But 14 different states in one term to share a border with modern China as well. Inside of China, most of the population are Han, ethnic group, dominant population to be sure, but there are 55 officially identified, designated ethnic groups, several of those in the millions inside of China, and that's an important consideration, understanding at least the sociology and the politics of modern China in some very real ways. 51 cities, the last time I looked, in China that are over a million. I think there are 9 in the United States, just to kind of keep those things. So one can be numbed by those numbers, perhaps, but it's important, I think, for us to appreciate that in a very real sense. Talk a little bit about sort of the way in which China is organized politically in today's China and to focus a bit on how this matters with regard to the contemporary newspaper headlines in Hong Kong as well. This, of course, is the picture that most of you will recognize, the entrance to the Forbidden City, and there hangs the portrait of Mao. I read recently a very interesting novel in which a Canadian journalist posed the question, you know, when will the time come when the portrait of Mao will be taken down from the Forbidden City? And the conversation, in essence, is that if Mao were alive today, he very well might take down that portrait himself. And that's an interesting dynamic. But I think it is important to appreciate here the dimension of China. This is, of course, a map of China. Some of it's in Chinese, so you're just going to have to, but it's in English as well. Politically, it's important to understand that China is a unitary state. Which means it's organized in a fashion like France, or like the United Kingdom, or like, in fact, most countries in the world. These are unitary states where, at least constitutionally and legally, power is centralized, and whatever political divisions emanate from that central authority. That has no particular bearing on whether or not China is or is not an open society, but it is certainly a bearing on how China is organized. Officially, China sees itself organized in some 34 different units. 23 of those are provinces. That includes, incidentally, their claim about including Taiwan. But 23 provinces, 5 autonomous regions. 5 autonomous regions. Regions here, 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 and here, and here. These would be the two largest in the west. This would be in Tibet, Manhua, or Xinjiang. In the northwest, Xinjiang is the home of a large number of Uyghurs, the large ethnic group. These are, in most cases, Muslim populations that have, from time to time, been a major concern for the Chinese government as well. But in addition to those 5 autonomous regions, and this is a concept really drawn from the old Soviet experience as well, where you set up governing units that were ostensibly autonomous, built around certain ethnic populations. Four municipalities that don't necessarily report through the county system or the regional system in China. This includes the four major cities of Beijing, Tianjin, Shanghai, and Chongqing, four of the largest cities in China that have that independent status as well, at least legally. And then two, in a very interesting fashion, called special administrative regions, namely Hong Kong and Macau. Hong Kong and Macau down here. Hong Kong, of course, being a former British colony, 150 years, dating from the middle of the 19th century until 1997, in which finally, after years of negotiation, Hong Kong was ceded over to the Chinese under the rubric of a special administrative region. And Macau, a former Portuguese colony, that occupied this little colony, came in, I think, 2 or 3 years after Hong Kong, and now under the legal auspices of the Chinese as well. A couple of words here, though, in order to appreciate, I think, some of the events that have been going on in Hong Kong recently. The negotiations between the British and the Chinese and the entity in Hong Kong that resulted in Hong Kong being turned over to the Chinese are incorporated essentially in what is called the Basic Law. The Basic Law, which governs the relationship between Hong Kong and, if you will, Beijing. And in that Basic Law, if you read it, it's a fairly lengthy document that has quite a few references to political notions that are references that would be found in almost any kind of Western constitutional document about protection of certain individual rights, a commitment to this or to several notions of Western democratic practices, and included in that is the means by which China or Hong Kong was to be ostensibly governed. There's a council of some 1,200 folks that were to, from the votes of those 1,200 folks, were to decide the leadership in Hong Kong up until 2017. And in 2017, that issue about belonging to that council was then to be opened up to universal suffrage. But herein lies the rub. For the government in Beijing, by and large, the notion was one country, two systems. For Beijing, the notion of one country has obviously become much more important than two systems. And for Beijing, for the interpretation given recently by the government in Beijing to what that meant, in the transfer to universal suffrage for the Basic Law in 2017 was that the Beijing government would retain that is the leadership, the membership of the council would indeed retain sort of veto power over the slate of candidates that eventually would run for those offices. Well, that means that ostensibly from the point of view of Beijing, their notion of who's going to be on the ballot is very much like the role of the Beijing government elsewhere, who's going to be on the ballot. You can vote for whomever you like, but here are the candidates on the ballot. This has at least been the political struggle inside of some of the recent events in Hong Kong. Now, I would venture to say, in my own small amount of insight here, that that's not the only issue. There are other issues that have been very powerful on the political landscape here. Certainly a younger generation in Hong Kong, so 7+ million people who are, for the most part, fairly well-educated, comparatively speaking, fairly wealthy, and who are having a very difficult time finding employment, and indeed finding housing. Housing's extremely expensive in Hong Kong, as well as not amply available. That's an issue as well, and it's no accident that, by and large, the protest movement is from the younger generation, and concerns about things of the recent candidates and their the lurid details of some of their lives, as well as in terms of the political candidates, the ostentatious display of wealth by some family members of political leaders. All of these things have kind of crept into the discussion and come to a head in what is called recently the Umbrella Revolution. But the point of view of understanding modern China, this is a big issue. This is an issue which is probably going to continue give problems to the Chinese government as to how to incorporate, particularly Hong Kong. Macau is much less of a challenge. Macau has really become largely a place of tourism and recreation and gambling, particularly from the new crop of millionaires from mainland China. And I might add also that there's also a very interesting phenomenon going on in Hong Kong over the last decade or so, which has become a huge vacation spot for people from the mainland. And there's some real tensions between those two populations, particularly as the new vacationers have become somewhat wealthy themselves as well. Well, enough of that. Let's move on to the other item I want to talk about here is sort of the leadership in China itself and the changes in leadership. Here you have the most recent Chinese leader on your left, Xi Jinping, and the previous leader in China, Hu Jintao. This change occurred in November of 2012, coincided essentially with the re-election of the American president. And there were a lot of commentators who talked about the beginning of the Chinese era and the second term of the American president almost at the same time, and their interplay. The dynamics of getting to this point in essentially a peaceful transfer of leadership in China is certainly no small concern, but the dynamics of that flowed from the events of the 18th Party Congress earlier in 2012 and the People's Congress as well, and its final selection in November. What's interesting, I think, to note here is to be reminded about Xi himself, Xi Jinping. He is, I think, likely to become one of the three most important Chinese leaders of the post-Mao period, or of the post-revolutionary period. Mao, Deng Xiaoping, and Xi Jinping certainly has that potential. His father was the founder of one of the comrades of Mao himself. He is then, by definition, a kind of a princeling, which is a phenomenon you will find and hear about in China itself. The notion of the sons and daughters of people who were comrades in arms during the revolution and their status. Come on. Some of that has been a very favored status, and sometimes it's been a very troubled status as well. You may have read a year or so ago the commentary of one Bo Xilai in China, who was also part of that inner circle of Mao Zedong and slated to be perhaps the future leader of China, could have been where Xi Jinping is today had it not been for his own demise and the life and troubles of his wife and son, all of which played out in a very torrid sense, and now find at least as the father and the mother in life sentences of prison due to really the killing of a British businessman and some charges of corruption. But Xi Jinping, nevertheless, despite his princeling status, had worked his way up as both a party bureaucrat and a government bureaucrat, holding office in the county, provincial, and party leadership at various levels, well-educated, very strong personality, very charismatic. You may remember a few years ago came to the United States when he was a kind of second-tier member of the Chinese government, endeared himself to a small community in Missouri. In ways that it's really kind of a fascinating story. And when he came back last year to meet in the summit with President Obama in Southern California, some of that community went to Southern California to greet and to welcome him again. But when I read Xi Jinping, I've tried to follow him fairly carefully, both in the American and at least the Chinese, the English-speaking Chinese press. He's very interested in sort of emphasizing his style around the idea of the Chinese dream, and part of that is the rejuvenation of what he calls the Chinese nation. And this is in keeping with, a deeply embedded notion that you'll find in modern China today. If you go to Tiananmen Square today, one part of the square is completely dominated by a brand new museum dedicated to the history of China, and there's an enormous portion of that museum dedicated what they call the rejuvenation of the Chinese nation, which essentially is primarily a look at China since the middle of the 19th century, the period of the of the European encroachments, the period of the Chinese defeats, both by the British and later by the Japanese, and eventually, from the Chinese point of view, by others as well. But to overcome that period in their own self-image, I think, is some of the ways very heavily on Xi Jinping's mind. There is coupled with this, from my perspective, a very interesting resurgence of Confucianism in modern China as well. Confucianism was something that clearly was a target of the Maoist forces and the Maoist regimes in the early days of the revolution, seen as part of the old order, that part that was to be done away with. And you're seeing, I think, in China today, an interesting resurgence about the values of Confucianism. One example I would point you to that is that there are now in the world, last time I looked, 114 Confucian institutes now established throughout the world, a number of those in the United States, most of them affiliated with American universities, but intended very much to seed and to facilitate the study of China, Chinese language and Chinese customs and Chinese politics, and done in the same way that the Goethe Institute does with Germany, that other entities do with the British and the French as well. And the Chinese are, I think, very interested in this kind of thing, and you are beginning to see the resurrection of this notion of the legacy of Confucius. So we went on a weekend, we traveled a lot in China and Beijing itself, and certainly in the country itself, and every weekend we'd find ourselves to do something. So one weekend we took the fast train to Chufu, which is the birthplace of Confucius. And it is absolutely amazing to me, not only what's there, but the streams of tourists, particularly Chinese tourists, who are coming to that, and now 20, 30, 40 years ago, that simply would not have taken place. So you are beginning to see that. I taught a class on Chinese politics when I came back from China here, and one day I simply took to class, after we'd been in class for a couple of months, I simply took to class and my copy of Mao's Little Red Book and the Analects of Confucius, and passed them around and said, okay, now you turn to page 14 on this one and 21 on this one, and read it, and can you talk about what that means in terms of understanding China today? That's more than just a menial little exercise. That's a very useful way to kind of see the way in which those two phenomena have dominated recent Chinese society and are seen emerging again today as well. Let me move on here, and I know we're going to probably run a little short of time, but I want to talk a little bit about some issues of Chinese foreign policy, particularly issues that have to do with the challenges in the Chinese in the East China Sea and in the South China Sea. The most widely discussed of these are, of course, the disputes about these small number of little islands that are northeast of Taiwan. Off the coast of Southeast China, to the west of Okinawa and the Japanese holdings as well. In Japan, they call these the Senkaku Islands. They can't even agree on what their names are. What's really interesting, depending on who's telling the story, there are either three islands or eight islands. They're all very small. Altogether, they don't amount to more than a few square kilometers. And most of them are uninhabited. There are a few goats here, and in recent times there have been a few Chinese and Japanese students who've tried to wade ashore to try to foist their claims, but by and large, it's an amazing story that's gotten great importance in the international world, certainly from the Chinese and the Japanese point of view, over some pieces of land that, except for some potential resources in the seas around them, don't matter a whole lot, but symbolically, they matter very much. In mainland China, they're called the Diaoyu. In Taiwan, the Diaoyu Tai, and you even see the British refer to them as the Pinnacle Islands as well. These are islands that the diplomatic story and account behind them is kind of complex, but essentially important to understand here that these were islands that, by and large, the Chinese, if you go back far enough in history, will always tell you they've always claimed. Let me share with you a map I found in a Chinese textbook. This is a map of 1954, in which simply is intended to sketch out the Chinese view of their spheres of influence. The broader black line is intended to be that area of China that was always under their dominion, and the other one at various times. But it gives you some idea. We're talking about here of at least a claim of control of not just land, but the waters of almost all of the South China Sea and the East China Sea as well. The problem is, of course, that these same waters, by almost any criteria, certainly under international law, are waters that other states lay claim to as well. Vietnam, the Philippines, Brunei, Japan, Korea. These particular islands, these particular contests, they're not, I belittle the importance of it by suggesting that we're talking about islands that don't matter very much, because there are some important resources in this area of the world. There is some oil, there are some other minerals to be exploited there as well. And certainly these are major strategic waterways. But probably more than that, these are areas of the world that for the Chinese are simply historically important. And for more than anything in recent times, this is an area where the Chinese and the Japanese are simply at loggerheads. And this is not a new incident. For the Chinese, for many of the Chinese, certainly for my students, the notion of being able to deal with Japan today is a very troublesome one. And part of the notion of the rejuvenation of the Chinese dream and the Chinese nation is to correct those mistakes that were carried out with the support of much of the rest of the world on China by the Japanese. And if you want to sort of further your understanding about this, you really have to go back and look at especially the events of the Second World War. For the Chinese, for many Chinese intellectuals at least, the Second World War began in Asia. Indeed, the shooting did start as early as 1937. And for the Chinese, as many as 30 to 35 million people, Chinese, died in the Second World War. Well, that's a number that even exceeds the number of deaths from the Soviets, and certainly even the Western powers as well. And that and the events that occurred by the Japanese invasion and air bombardment of Shanghai, and eventually the rape of Nanjing, are simply parts of modern Chinese history that a lot of people have not yet come to resolve. And I can share with you one little incident. I remember going to class one day, and our topic was about issues of international trade. And I kidded my students. I said, you know, here we are, the Japanese are among your major partners in the world, and they are. It's very hard for you to get over this business of not liking the Japanese in general, not just not just specific Japanese, but the Japanese in general. And I said, I suspect the feeling's mutual. And I said, why is that? And they would smile a little bit and say, well, you know, that's trade, that's business. And my answer was, you know, you bloody capitalists, you've come around a long way. there's some too, but this notion of antipathy and antagonism between the Chinese and the Japanese is very real. We went to Nanjing and spent a day in the museum in Nanjing commemorating the Nanjing massacre, where as many as 300,000 Chinese civilians mostly were killed and tortured and raped in the Japanese invasion of the 1930s, and this is something that experience in that museum is as powerful as I personally have ever experienced in my life, and that would include experiences at Dachau, experiences at the Jewish Museum in Berlin, the Holocaust Museum in Washington. That museum is as powerful in terms of grabbing your emotions about that event as anything I think you've ever seen. Well, my point is that this part of understanding China is an essential, critical part of understanding the changes in modern China. Let me finish with just a few comments about the Chinese economy, and then maybe we'll have time for a couple of questions or so. Oh, I needed to point out that this is a map which you'll often see in conversations with the Chinese about the issues in the South China Sea. Notice the little dashes here, little red dashes around the sea. Those are called the nine dashes. And the nine dashes is almost invariably the account of where the Chinese control of those seas should lead to. You almost always see that phrase. China on the rise. Chinese economy, just a few quick things. 1980, the Chinese economy was about the size of the Netherlands. 30 years later, Chinese economy is the second largest in the world, arguably going to be the largest economy in the world in the not too distant future. In 1980, it produced 2% of the world's GDP. Today, it's at 16%. That's in essentially a generation and a half. This is not your grandfather's version of communist China. This is a society and a state that has undergone largely under the astute leadership of Deng Xiaoping, in my opinion. I got very fascinated with Deng Xiaoping while I was in China. I managed to get my hands on a brand new biography that had been published by a Harvard scholar, and my daughter sent me the book, and then I found a book in the Chinese bookstore of a biography by Deng, by his daughter, and to read those two accounts of his biography was just extraordinary. But Deng Xiaoping is, in my judgment, the unsung hero of the Chinese Revolution up until today. But it is essentially meant that most of the China, of the reforms in the Chinese economy have been geared to the market entering into Chinese decision making. Some of those rules of the old political order not only are being rewritten, they're being dominated by those economic changes as well. As to whether or not economic reform drives political reform, I think that question is still open for debate. The thing that makes the Chinese political elites most nervous today is the possibility of the challenging of the hold on political power of the Chinese Communist Party. And that hasn't happened very much. You can talk about it being maybe at the edges, but not very much. So in essence, you have a kind of worldwide, globalized market economy that's at work domestically and certainly is at work in terms of Chinese relationships with the rest of the world in the context of a fairly authoritarian political system dominated by the party. There's certainly some literature in the world of politics that suggests that political reform will sometimes follow economic reform. That happens in China, I think, remains to be seen. It's not going to happen tomorrow, but enormous changes have happened, already. The Chinese are very concerned about sort of the direction of the Chinese economy. They have experienced domestic growth rates in the double digits. I think I have some figures here somewhere. Yeah. Those are 2012 figures, and comparing it to what are called the other BRIC nations, which they're often compared to. Those are countries with economies on the rise: Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. 7.8 is a low mark for the Chinese today. Really, the growth rate has been in the double digits for several years, but the Chinese are very concerned about seeing it dip at this level. And there's great concern by the Chinese to be able to shift from government investments and government nurturing of certain sectors and dependence on international trade to an economy also driven by consumer spending. By Chinese consumers as they acquire more and more disposable income and let that drive the economy as well. And I think that's probably likely to dominate the landscape of the near future. There are some internal issues that I think associated with this. One has to do with migrants and their economic impact inside of China. There are currently somewhere in the neighborhood of 150 to 200 million Chinese migrants that largely have migrated to Chinese cities. Now, that's a big issue because Legally, you just can't pick up and move and decide that you have a new address in China in a new city. You're like a Slavic peasant. You're not quite sure where the map is, but you just can't go there and set up and assume households with the same kinds of rights to own property and so forth as you might have had before then. There's been some impact on this of the one-child policy as well, which went through some relaxation a little over a year ago. And I must add parenthetically that the one-child policy, which a lot of people in the West sort of associate with modern China, while still in place, it's genuinely relaxed. It does not apply to the 55 ethnic minorities either. Today, essentially, the general rule is that if indeed you come from a one-child family and your spouse comes from a one-child family, you are an exception to the rule as well. So there's some serious relaxation about some real concerns about growing inequalities inside of China, as you see a new wealthy, certainly class and population, that you'll see some concern of the Chinese leadership as well. Well, that's a bit of an overview of some major problems affecting Chinese today, and I know we're pressed up against time, and I want to save at least a few minutes for any questions or comments you might have. So thank you all very much. I think the idea was that we'd like to end on the hour, but let me take any questions you might have. Rebecca.
Two questions. First of all, that map you showed of what China thinks of as its area that includes
sphere of influence.
Southeast Asia. Now, are they referring back to emperors and empires of Chinese empire in long centuries past, or where are they getting this idea from?
If you talk to folks, and in particular this comes up with regard to issues in the South China Sea, they don't see Thailand, Cambodia, Burma, Laos, that kind of thing as part of modern day China, although remember there's some important enclaves of Chinese populations in those states as well. But this becomes the talking point. It becomes the talking point of the idea of the rejuvenation of the real Chinese nation. But no, they don't lay claims to the land. But certainly, with regard to the sea, they do. They then talk about the nine dashes.
Well, I'm thinking, what are they basing this on historically? Do they refer back to the fact, you know, of course, that a lot of Southeast Asia has high ethnic Chinese populations and much influence in the culture? Are they referring to times in the past when these were part of the Chinese empire?
Yes. Other questions, comments? Yes.
The one-child policy, will it be on hold or change in the future?
Will there be changes in the future? Well, I don't know, you know. It's
I'm wondering, because who will take care of the elderly then?
Well, that's the problem that, you know, many people point out. There are enormous issues, and there are enormous pressures, I think, coming along for Chinese. And when you would talk to students about this, and I would tell you that I had some of the best students in China that I'm certain of, really good students. And I might tell you that of the best students I had juniors and seniors and PhD students, the best students were women. That's a really interesting phenomenon, because the Chinese Foreign Service is dominated by males. So they got a huge problem just coming along in that little sub-population. But when you talk about this issue of the one-child policy, real notions of anxiety and concern. Yet on the other hand, there's clearly the recognition that in terms of public policy, this solved a huge problem for the Chinese. You know, a huge problem for the Chinese. And you can talk about the sort of arbitrariness or the harshness of it, or even the inequities of it, even today. But still, as a public policy measure, this was a response to a devastating problem for the Chinese.
I'm just going to call them Binhuangs because I can't pronounce the rest of the names.
Okay, Sir Ernest will probably like you, but go ahead.
Okay, so these islands, he said they're very symbolic of, well, the Chinese and Japan and I guess Korea. I don't know what ROT means. Taiwan. So they're butting heads. So if that issue is to be resolved, would it signal a change in policy or a change in the balance of power?
Those issues, that's a good question, and I don't mean to be frivolous about it. If there's a place where a accidental spark could set up a tinderbox, frankly, and result in a conflagration that you wouldn't want to see happen, it could be around these kind of things, because these passions run very deep. And part of it is this. This is largely a tension between the Japanese and the Chinese. Most of the other stuff is peripheral. And part of it has to do with, if you look back at the settlements following great wars in the 20th century, World War I, but especially World War II. Now think about who were the defeated powers in World War II? The Japanese. Who were on the victorious side? At least ostensibly the Chinese were. These islands were given back to the Japanese eventually. Actually, for a period of time, they were put under a trusteeship that was administered by the United States. Even as late as 1972, these islands were returned to the Japanese. This gets in the craw of the Chinese in a way that you almost cannot imagine, because they see this as further nurturing the notion of really an arch enemy here. Now, in recent times, it's been interesting because these islands were actually purchased by a Japanese financier. And then the Japanese government, I think out of fear that this might escalate into something out of control, actually purchased the islands from him under some duress so that he couldn't do with them what they want to do privately. And so it is a huge catalyst and tinderbox for tension, but it's really emblematic more of the emerging struggle of a rising Chinese nation and state, and certainly the Japanese influence in this area as well.
What's the main religion that's practiced in China? Are they Buddhist? And my second question is Confucianism a religion?
Not really. Confucianism is more a way of life. It's not a religion in the sense that we know, but the largest formal world religion in China would be Buddhist, yes. And I think the estimates are, it's hard to, that somewhere around 40%. But Buddhist temples are not only omnipresent, they're open, they're practicing there are open churches, including Christian churches that are formally designated that are open as well. Not every single practice of religion is open and abided by. It's under the approval of the party. The party genuinely, I think, does see itself threatened by the idea of organized groups that are facilitating goals that are in ways threatening to them. You'll see that. Yeah. Yes.
What did you find was the domestic sentiment, if you will, among your students about the crackdown on corruption that's emanating out of Xi Jinping?
Of course, it's been 2 years since I've been there, personally, but I think there's widespread support, at least among students, for crackdown on corruption. That's in part why, if you think about this business of political leadership. If anything happened in the Chinese experience following Mao and the sort of really almost despicable practices that sometimes happened under his leadership through the Cultural Revolution, there is a recognition, I think, within the Chinese leadership about the need to have a more collective leadership and not let this be a sort of one party, one man rule. If you look at the evolution of Chinese leadership, I think that's pretty clear that that's the ethos behind leadership after the death of Mao, up until Xi Jinping. And even though the decision to sort of allow Xi Jinping to have a more concentrated focus on leadership came from a collective sentiment, he clearly is in a position, at least appears to be in a position, partly because of the need and concern to crack down on corruption. which is fairly widespread, and he's had at least on the surface some major successes about that as well. So in general, you know, it's an interesting notion, and it's full of ambivalencies and ambiguities. There is this support for somebody to do something about it, but it's also probably acknowledging and facilitating the emergence of political power concentrated in a few.
That's interesting, because I often think about what does that mean, that on the surface, the crackdown looks well-founded, but what does that mean in terms of consolidation of power?
And as the issue of wealth expands in Chinese society, these issues are going to get even more important. And what I would say, the growing gaps of wealth as well. I think we're really pressed on the clock. I know you want to let keep in, so thank you all very much.
Thank you so much.